should impress the word of truth on our heart. Tonight, may we not be ashamed to make a decision for you. Tonight, may we give ourselves completely to you. Now, if there is someone who is here, who is sick, let there be healing. Let there be anointing. If there is someone here who has a burden, your word says, you are our burden bearer. Please set someone free. Amen. Give someone light tonight. Amen. I am better sinner. So hide me behind the cross. Let me not speak my own words. We are in the last days. Let me speak the words of Jesus. Let the Holy Spirit back every word, every action, every gesture. May it be impressive on the heart of all of us tonight. Not I, but Christ. Be honored, loved, and exalted. Not I, but Christ. Be seen, be known, and be heard. Not I, but Christ. In every look and action, not I, but Christ, in every thought and word, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We can have our seats. As I always do, it was Jesus himself who said, if you continue in my words, then you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. If the Son set you free, you shall be free in it. Can you say an amen there? Amen. I don't make this statement because I just feel like talking every night about it. Watch it again. It's in fact a quote from John chapter 8, from verse 32 down to verse 36, 38. It says, if you continue in my words, then you are my disciple. Only disciples will go to heaven. So Jesus says, the only way you can be a Christian is to continue in the word. Then you will know the truth, the untold truth. The only way to know the truth is to continue in the word, and the truth will set you free. In other words, if you don't know the truth, you will be in what? Bondage. If you don't know the truth, you are a slave. If you don't know the truth, you are not free. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. The truth is Jesus. I am the way, the truth. So Jesus says, if I, the Son, I set you free, indeed you will be free. It's an affirmation of faith. So I meant to you five promises. Promise number one is the Bible shall be the bedrock of our study. And the reason is the Bible means what it says and says what it means. Don't take God for granted. He's not a comedian. He is a serious man. He says, what I say, I mean it. What he means is what he says. So tonight, he will demand you to make a decision. Don't take him for a ride. Promise number two, you shall be enlightened. Irrespective of who you are, your word is a lie. So when we use the word, there is enlightenment. Promise number three, you'll be challenged to make the most important decision of your life. Your word is like a two-edged sword. It divides both the bone and the marrow. When the word of God comes, decisions must be made. Today, if you hear his word, hearken not your heart. You will make a decision. And promise number four, those who love God, they will be baptized. And promise number five is your life will never be the same. Will you not say an amen there? Amen. Yesterday we dealt with when truth shall reign. And we saw the second coming of Jesus, that he will come and he will come to establish the kingdom of truth. He came the first time to establish the principles of truth. He's coming the second time to establish now the kingdom of truth. So his coming is literal, it's personal, it's visible, it's audible, it's glorious, it's climatic, and it's very decisive. A decision must be made in that regard. For tonight, our topic is the untold truth accepts his adoption. Accepts his adoption. Accepts his adoption. If Jesus is going to come one of these days, because he will come and the whole world will notice that he's coming, the question must be, who will he come for? Yesterday we saw that neither fornicators, nor adulterers, nor sinners, nor infirmites, nor homosexuals, nor perverse men and women will enter the kingdom of God. So then, how can you and I become partakers of God's divine nature? We are talking about adoption. Adoption. Romans chapter 8, verse 15. He says, for you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of all adoption, by which we cry, Abba. We are not Jews. We are Gentiles. We were not to be saved, but God, in his wisdom, he used a miraculous principle that men and women in Africa, men and women in Asia, men and women in Europe, men and women across the globe, we have been adopted. When somebody is adopted, it means you are not initially part of the heritage. You are not initially part of the family. Adoption is a principle of grace. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear. If there is someone here who is afraid, the Bible says, if you are God's child, if you submit yourself to Jesus, you have received the spirit of adoption. That is why today we have the audacity, when we need something, we go to God and we call his name Abba. Will you not say an amen here? It says the spirit himself. This is a Hebrew parallelism. It's making emphasis. The spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are all children of God. In other words, today's message is, how can you become a child of God? How can I become a child of God? How can God accept a sinner who has sinned in Lagos, in Nigeria, in Africa? You watching us through this live streaming, how can you become a child of God? And if we are their children, then we are heirs of God. In other words, it is now by privilege a right. And the Bible says, and we are joined, yes, with Christ. When you are a heir, in Genesis 24, when Eliezer was the only faithful servant in the home of Abraham, Abraham had not given birth to Isaac. He was planning to make Eliezer his heir. But when he brought forth a child called Isaac, Isaac became the heir. The Bible says, when we are adopted into the kingdom of grace, into the kingdom of truth, into the brotherhood of God's principle, then we are joint heirs. We are co-laborers with God through Christ. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4 and 7. I love this one. It says, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem, underline, to redeem those who were under the law. I will explain this tomorrow, but to be under the law means I will save myself without Jesus to make us part of the family of God. And because you are sons, this is a generic sense, it means sons and daughters. God has sent forth the spirit of his son into your hearts. God has sent out the spirit of the Holy Spirit into your heart. God has sent forth his spirit into our heart, crying out, meaning we have the right by privilege to call God Abba, our Father. And he says, therefore, you are no longer a slave, but you are a son. And if a son, then you are heir through Christ, because Christ was called or is called the Son of God. Will somebody not say an amen here? I am privileged to be in Satellite, to be in Lagos, to be in Africa, to be in Europe. Wherever you are watching, you are privileged that you can become a heir of God through Christ Jesus. I am privileged. But what step do I need to take to accept this headship? Ladies and gentlemen, it means, how can I become adopted? How can I become a member of God's family? How can I become a member of God's children? How can I be an adopted child, an adopted boy, an adopted girl, an adopted woman, an adopted man? How can I become a member of God's end time family? Adoption has some benefits. When you are adopted, you eat the food sons eat. So when you are adopted into God's kingdom, you don't eat any kind of food anymore. You don't dress anyhow anymore. That is why in the Bible, Christians must not eat every food. Leviticus chapter 11, you don't eat like any other body. The reason is that you are no more like those in the world. You are adopted. When Buhari adopts you as a son, as a daughter, and you are in his palace, or you are representing wherever you are, your dressing must change. Your eating must change. Security may begin to wash over you. How can angels of God begin to be my security man? Angels, how can I be an adopted son? How can you be an adopted daughter? And you dress like the world. You dress like those outside. You dress and eat anyhow. You talk anyhow. How can you be a Christian? And when you speak, you represent the God you call. Lifestyles change. There is a better home. There is a better future. When you are adopted, it comes with some benefit. Ladies and gentlemen, adoption. God has a family both on earth and in heaven. People who accept the grace of truth and their names are written in the Lamb's book of life. Christ never sinned, yet he became sin for us so that we can become adopted sons and adopted children. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ. For as many as were baptized into Christ, you have put on Christ. The Bible says baptism is the way for adoption. Wouldn't you not say amen there? He said baptism is the doorway for you to become a child of God. It means baptism is the way for God to accept you, for God to protect you, for God to preserve you, for God to make you so. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. As many of you were baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. The book of Revelation is the book of adoption. The book of Revelation reveals how we can be adopted. In the book of Revelation, chapter 2, chapter 3, verse 12, he says, he who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more. I will write on him the name of my God. When you are adopted, the name of the adoptee is transferred to you. And the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which come down out of heaven from my God, and I will write on him which name? My new name. That is a stamp of adoption. Baptism. It is the Christian. It is the sinner. It is that man. It is that woman. It is that girl. It is that boy. The privilege to be adopted by God. Revelation. Put it this way. And after this, I look and behold a great multitude which no one could number, from every nation. Every nation means from Nigeria too. From all tribe. Every tribe means your tribe too. From all people. All people means you too. From all tongues. All tongues means from every language. Your language you speak as well. It says they were standing before the throne of God and before the Lamb, and they were clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands. Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, who are these who are clothed in white robes, and hence have they come? And he says, I said to him, sir, you know. And he said to me, these are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. How can you put a white cloth in the blood and it becomes white? That is an oxymoron. That is an oxymoron. How can a cloth be dipped in blood and it becomes white? It is talking about a principle of adoption. Is there a woman here who feels far away from God and wants to be adopted today? Is there a man? Is there a boy? Is there a girl who feels very far from God and he wants to be adopted? Once upon a time, there was a great preacher. His name was Saul. He was a Roman citizen by birth. Very educated under the great Rabbi Gamaliel. He was a teacher in Jerusalem. He persecuted God's people. He was zealous for the Jewish religion. Some of you have been here. You have been zealous for the wrong purpose. Zealous for error. Zealous for falsehood. Zealous for that which must not be zealous for. He was doing it ignorantly. One day, the Bible says, Saul, better known as Paul, when he became a Christian, described what happened to him. How God adopted him. How God changed him. Adoption means when you are brought in, I said it, your lifestyle, your food, your dress code, your perception, you are now a different person. One day he narrates Acts chapter 22, verse 4. He said, I persecuted to death, binding and delivering into prison both men and women, referring to the Christians of Jesus. And went to Damascus to bring in chains. He chained them, even those who were in Jerusalem, so that they would be punished. One day, he was on his way to Damascus to bring more people so that they would arrest them. And the Bible says, light shone on him from heaven. The light struck him down on the ground. He reported himself in Acts 22, verse 7. He says, he heard a voice, and the voice says, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Some of you may be aware, or may not be aware, you have been persecuting the truth this week. God will strike you with his light. He will hold you hostage. He will call you by your name. My sister, why are you persecuting me? You are doing it ignorantly. Why are you persecuting me? And the Bible says, when you persecute Jesus, it means you persecute the truth. Because the one saying, he says, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And listen to this. He says, so I answered, who are you, Lord? And he says to me, I am Jesus. Remember, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Saul was persecuting the truth. So Jesus says, you are persecuting me. What shall I do, Lord? He said. And the Lord said, arise, go into Damascus. And there you'll be told. Maybe you are told. You'll be told
What will he be told? What he has never heard? What he has not believed? What he seems to be ridiculous? He never believed that the Christians were right. Some of you have been coming to this meeting. You are watching downstream. You have been persecuting some truth. You never know. You thought it was falsehood. The Bible says, and there you'll be told what to do. God has brought you into this meeting so that you'll be told what to do. He has brought you here so that you encounter truth. He has brought you here like he did to Saul on the road to Damascus. Yours is at satellite. It's at this auditorium. It's in this place. It's via that satellite. He says, you will do what to do. The things which are appointed for you that you will do. So Saul, he could not see anymore. He was blinded by the lie. So he went into Damascus for 3 days. He was searching his heart. I believe Saul might be singing the song, search me, O God. And oh my hearts today, try me, oh Savior. He might be singing that song. When he wakes up in the morning, this great man, this well-educated man, might be singing that song, which says, search me, oh Lord. He may be searching himself like the way some of you ought to be searching yourself right now. And you'll be singing, I want to believe in the eye of faith. I can see Saul. If it were to be today, you'll be singing the song, search me, O Lord, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior. He was searching his soul. He saw the way he had hatred for the sons of God. And the Spirit of God impressed on his heart. Then God sent for him the following few days. He sent a man. His name is Prophet Ananias. Ananias came and said to Saul, yea, brother Saul, I'm talking about Acts chapter 22 from verse 13. Brother Saul, receive your sight. And at that same hour, I looked up at him. He received his sight. Somebody say an amen here. Yeah. Some of us are blind when it comes to biblical knowledge. We are blind when it comes to God's will. We are blind when it comes to following the truth. God says, this week, this few days left, he will send to us an Ananias. And you expound to us the ills we have perpetrated on the school. Brother Saul, put your name there. Sister Ivan, Sister Shola, Sister whatever, Brother what? You name yourself. You receive your sight. Begin to see God's word differently. Begin to think differently. Begin to behave differently. Will you not say amen there? Yeah. So Saul received his sight. Then he said, the God of our fathers has chosen you. May God choose you today. Yeah. May God choose you today. Yeah. May God adopt you today. Yeah. When he told this to Saul, and that he should know his will, did you get that? God wants to adopt Saul. So he sent a prophet to expound the Bible to him. And he says, the God of our fathers has chosen you that you should know his will. You can never be adopted and be a bona fide son and be a bona fide daughter without knowing the will of the one who has adopted you. Those who saw, they taught him that he would know God's will and see the just one and hear the voice of his mouth. For you will be his witness to all men of what you have seen and what you have heard. And the Bible says, in Acts 22 verse 16, and he said, and now, why are you tarrying? Why are you waiting? Arise for Saul to be adopted, for him to know the will of God completely, for him to become a tool in the hand of God to use. God says, Saul was told that he must arise. He must not wait any longer. He must baptize so that his sins will be washed away. Will you not say an amen here? God made it so, he made it so plain, he made it so clear, that Saul, you must be baptized, so that you can call on the name of God. Somebody will be asked tonight to make a decision like Saul. The Bible says, Saul went downstream, he was baptized, he received his sign, he has been adopted into the family of God. I want to tell you tonight, have you wished you could start life all over again? The sins you have committed, the ills you have committed, the way you felt you have been strained away from God. You have left the kingdom of grace. You have left the kingdom of truth. You have gone far away from God. God will be calling on you today to make a choice. Once upon a time, there was a preacher. His name, John, because he was good in bringing people into adoption of the kingdom of truth, he is called John the Baptist. In Matthew chapter 3, verse 5, the Bible says, then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region around about the Jordan. Then and they were baptized of him in Jordan, and they were confessing their sins. Whilst he was baptizing, back then Jesus closed the doors of his carpentry shop. And Jesus' mother bade him farewell. He joined the crowds. Jesus was making his way to Jordan. And John caught sight of him. And John said this in the book of Mark, John chapter 1, verse 29. He saw Jesus and he said, behold, the Lamb of God who took away the sins of the world. Jesus is the one. John the Baptist recognized the true sacrificial lamb, the one who can reconcile man, the one who can adopt. So he doesn't want to baptize Jesus. He said, I rather must be adopted by you. I must not baptize you. And the Bible says in Matthew 3, verse 14, John says, Jesus says, I need to be baptized by you. John instantly said that. Let it be now. It is proper for us to do this.